Dealing with Depression, written by the Centre of Excellence, narrated by Brian Greyson. Centre of Excellence, Dealing with Depression course, Introduction. Welcome to the Dealing with Depression course from Centre of Excellence. This is a course designed for self-help and also helping others overcome depression. The information provided in the course brings together a lot of very recent findings on what depression is, why there has been a huge increase in cases, and how the sufferer can help themselves to overcome the condition in many ways. Suffering with depression can leave us feeling isolated and unmotivated. We are often confused at the intensity of sadness and hopelessness that comes with the condition, and in many cases, the worse we feel, the less able we are to act on feeling better. This course will show you how many options that we have to fight and deal with depression, no matter how intensely we feel it or how often we have suffered. It will also educate you in the importance of absolute individuality when assessing and deciding on a treatment plan for depression. We talk of food, lifestyle, stress, and life experiences, and how they affect the chemistry within us, which automatically changes how we feel. Then we discuss the alignment between holistic health and the most up-to-date medical views on the topic. It's a fantastic course, and one which you will learn a lot from. We hope you enjoy it. Dealing with Depression, Unit 1, Understanding. Unit 1 of the course explores depression in detail. It discusses what depression is, symptoms, and why we suffer. The objective of Unit 1 is to help the student in better understanding of the condition and how it affects the sufferer. Depression is a state of mind and body that prevents or hinders normal function. It happens for many reasons, and sometimes no reason at all. Over many generations, depression has been misunderstood, discarded, and treated in some worrying ways. Thankfully, we are beginning to understand it better than we have in the past, and more importantly, what can trigger the condition, along with how to treat it in a holistic and non-invasive way. Although we still have a lot to learn about depression, we have an amount of understanding now that can take us towards further knowledge of the condition and lasting improvement. There are a number of theories that explore the exact reasons for depression. Basically speaking, in biological science, it has long been believed to be a chemical imbalance in the brain. Yet experts are questioning the reason for an imbalance, along with whether and how it can be avoided or treated holistically. The human brain is complex and highly interesting. Neurons within the brain can become dysfunctional, lose the ability to communicate, or simply cease to produce enough of one chemical or start to produce too much of another. Neurotransmitters have an important job, and they too can become problematic in function, as can the signals that pass from one neuron to another. The questions that modern science has is whether this problem is simply a medical condition that cannot be avoided and always needs medication, or whether it is a change in the lifestyle and thought patterns of sufferers that reflects society as it is today. All of these things will be discussed within the course. There now follows an excerpt from Harvard Health, which talks of depression with a view to current research and the complex matter beyond the chemical imbalance. It's often said that depression results from a chemical imbalance, but that figure of speech doesn't capture how complex the disease is. Research suggests that depression doesn't spring from simply having too much or too little of certain brain chemicals. Rather, depression has many possible causes, including faulty mood regulation by the brain, genetic vulnerability, stressful life events, medications, and medical problems. It's believed that several of these forces interact to bring on depression. To be sure, chemicals are involved in the process, but it is not a simple matter of one chemical being too low and another too high. Rather, many chemicals are involved, working both inside and outside nerve cells. There are millions, even billions, of chemical reactions that make up the dynamic system that is responsible for your mood, perceptions, and how you experience life. With this level of complexity, you can see how two people might have similar symptoms of depression, but the problem on the inside, and therefore what treatments will work best, may be entirely different. Researchers have learned much about the biology of depression. they've identified genes that make individuals more vulnerable to low moods and influence how an individual does respond to drug therapy. One day these discoveries should lead to better, more individualized treatment, but that is likely to be years away. And while researchers know more now than ever before about how the brain regulates mood, their understanding of the biology of depression is far from complete. While the Harvard study talks of individualized treatment being many years in the future, it is important that we look towards every case of depression as an individual one right now. We are all different, and each person that suffers must carefully and extensively explore what helps and hinders recovery. The widespread condition of depression affects every person differently and for varying reasons. Therefore, individual exploration and treatment should similarly be a personal experience. Increasingly sophisticated forms of brain imaging, such as positron emission tomography, single photon emission computerized tomography, and functional magnetic resonance imaging, permit a much closer look at the working brain than was possible in the past. An fMRI scan, for example, can track changes that take place when a region of the brain responds during various tasks. A PET or SPECT scan can map the brain by measuring the distribution and density of neurotransmitter receptors in certain areas. Use of this technology has led to a better understanding of which brain regions regulate mood and how other functions, such as memory, may be affected by depression. Areas that play a significant role in depression are the amygdala, the thalamus, and the hippocampus. Research shows that the hippocampus is smaller in some depressed people. For example, in one fMRI study published in the Journal of Neuroscience, investigators studied 24 women who had a history of depression. On average, the hippocampus was 9 to 13% smaller in depressed women compared to those who were not depressed. The more bouts of depression a woman had, the smaller the hippocampus. Stress, which plays a role in depression, may be a key factor here, since experts believe stress can suppress the production of new neurons in the hippocampus. Researchers are exploring possible links between sluggish production of new neurons in the hippocampus and low moods. An interesting fact about antidepressants supports this theory. These medications immediately boost the concentration of chemical messengers in the brain. Yet people typically don't begin to feel better for several weeks or longer. Experts have long wondered why, if depression were primarily the result of low levels of neurotransmitters, people don't feel better as soon as levels of neurotransmitters increases. We'll now look at some areas of the brain in more detail. Firstly, the amygdala. The amygdala is part of the limbic system, a group of structures deep in the brain that's associated with emotions such as anger, pleasure, sorrow, fear, and sexual arousal. The amygdala is activated when a person recalls emotionally charged memories, such as a frightening situation. Activity in the amygdala is higher when a person is sad or clinically depressed. This increased activity continues even after recovery from depression. Now let's look at the thalamus. The thalamus receives most sensory information and relays it to the appropriate part of the cerebral cortex, which directs high-level functions such as speech, behavioral reactions, movement, thinking, and learning. Some research suggests that bipolar disorder may result from problems in the thalamus, which helps link sensory input to pleasant and unpleasant feelings. Finally, we'll look at the hippocampus. The hippocampus is part of the limbic system and has a central role in processing long-term memory and recollection. Interplay between the hippocampus and the amygdala might account for the adage, once bitten, twice shy. It is this part of the brain that registers fear when you are confronted by a barking aggressive dog, and the memory of such an experience may make you wary of dogs you come across later in life. The hippocampus is smaller in some depressed people, and research suggests that ongoing exposure to stress hormone impairs the growth of new cells in this part of the brain. So, how would you know that you had depression? Regular sufferers of depression know the feeling. They are well aware of how the black cloud comes over and, to an extent, can manage it. They have learned so much about themselves that depression is an area of life that they manage in the same way as diabetes or another manageable illness. If you have ever suffered and suspect you may be suffering now, then it's important that you really explore the symptoms of depression and consider it as a possibility. In a moment, I will list the symptoms.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.